C4 and Brian Neiman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
We're pleased to be joined by the county executive from Baltimore County for our monthly opportunity to find out what's happening in that county. Johnny Olszewski joins us right now. Good morning, county executive.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, gentlemen. Good morning.
Let me ask you first, county executive, because we, of course, have been going through our issues of violence in Baltimore City. We had a horrible weekend here of 17 people shot, four, maybe five homicides. But also recently, Baltimore County has seen an uptick. I saw you commenting on this. I just wanted to talk about it with you, where you have a 40% increase in homicides so far in the year of 2021 compared to a couple of years ago. Just give me your thoughts on that, county exec.
Yeah, look, the violence we're seeing, particularly in homicides, is not acceptable. It's not something that we're going to accept here in Baltimore County. Unfortunately, it's something that we're seeing across the country in terms of violence increases. But we also know that, we also know a lot of what we're seeing are behavioral and mental health related. That's why, in addition to continuing to execute our public safety plan in terms of the real-time event center, reorganization of our areas, investing in more squads to go into hotspots, we're also making those investments in things like the mental health supports that we know are causing a lot of the issues that have unfortunately been part of two mass shootings that we've seen in Baltimore County that has driven some of that number. But we've also launched, for example, a multi-departmental place initiative in Essex, where we know that that is a community that has seen historically faced unique public safety challenges. So we're tackling this comprehensively. And I will also say that we are seeing progress in other areas, but this increase in homicides is not and will not be accepted here.
In the mental health aspect of it, could you expand on that? Like, what exactly are you seeing, and is there any indication as to why it is happening?
Well, we certainly know that it is correlated with the pandemic. We are seeing I talked to experts at Shepherd Pratt with some regularity, and we are seeing higher levels of depression. We are seeing out in the field that people are having a harder time settling conflict, and that people are turning to violence more generally to solve their problems, be it with crime, be it in domestic violence relationships. Unfortunately, we are seeing people not having the tools. So we are investing both for police responses by expanding our behavioral health unit. We're installing trained practitioners to screen in our 911 center. But we're also using and looking at our recovery funds to invest more in mental health trainings for employees, for businesses in the community, and to put more counselors and support staff out into the streets to work with families who are facing issues like domestic violence, because we know that those problems are real. And we do believe that there's a strong correlation between what people are experiencing during this pandemic and some of the violence that we're seeing. And again, this is something that we're seeing nationally, but that we're taking very seriously at Baltimore County, investing both in the policing, but also in those other support services.
Baltimore County Executive Johnny Olszewski is on board with us this morning. And County Executive, we talked with this about this with Baltimore City Police Commissioner Michael Harrison, but these things that now have a name called sideshows, where you get all of these cars showing up in a particular area and they do these donuts and large crowds gather, and it looks very dangerous. Baltimore City's had them, but also Baltimore County has had some of these things as well. Are you coordinating with the city, since this seems to be a city-county thing on this type of event, County Executive?
So I'm aware of one that started and ended very quickly in Baltimore County, because we aren't going to risk the safety of our residents, and we're not going to have that kind of behavior be tolerated in Baltimore County. I can't speak for the commissioner in Baltimore City. Unless we're called in, though, some of these have occurred on the city-county border. We have an agreement where we only go in to execute law enforcement when asked to come in. So certainly I'm sure that the city has a plan, but I'm obviously responsible for the county, and we have taken serious action the one time I'm aware of where it tried to start up, but we promptly were able to shut it down here.
When it comes to police officers, how many officers are you short at this point right now?
I will get you guys the exact number. I will tell you that we are down some number of officers. I want to thank Chief Hyatt, not just for her response to the car issue that C4 mentioned, but she's taken the shortage very seriously. We announced a signing bonus of $10,000. We have a referral bonus for our officers. We work together to put in stipends for things like officers who have language proficiency from foreign language. We're trying to really make sure that we are hiring locally as best we can. So we're doing all that we can to invest. We have a lot of officers who are coming on retirement age. And look, let's be honest. This is a hard time to be a police officer. We expect the very best of our police officers, and you know, it is often a very challenging profession. So we want to make sure that we are recruiting the best, that we're training them appropriately, so that the expectations of the community are met. So we're confident that we have the staffing to keep our community safe. Baltimore County remains a safe place to live, work, and raise a family. And I'm working closely with the chief to make sure that we get those vacancies filled as quickly as possible.
An issue that is boiling up now in your county executive involves, and everybody's having to deal with this, redistricting, the lines that are drawn for the representation of different jurisdictions. And in Baltimore County, apparently, the new map that is out is under fire by civil rights groups and others for not reflecting the increase in minority population in your county. Let me get your thoughts on that, as apparently the public hearings are going to be held, one of them today, I believe, at 6 o'clock.
Yeah, I mean, I've said it before, and I'm happy to echo that I share the concerns that have been raised by those in our community about having a map that reflects the diversity of our county. We are a growing county, both in terms of population, but also in terms of our diversity. I'm glad to see that there were council members who appear open to taking those concerns seriously. And so I just want to remind folks that this is a council process. So I urge council members to take the concerns seriously and take a look at if we can address those concerns that have been raised. I'll also point out that one of the first things I did was introduce public financing, which we're in the process of finalizing and standing up for the next cycle in Baltimore County. That will help more candidates of color, more women, more non-traditional candidates also get involved. So the lines matter, but I think also public financing is a really important tool to make sure that, you know, these candidates who might not otherwise have access to the process have the resources to be successful candidates. So I'm really proud of our work on that front as well.
So you said that all county employees had until August or October 15th to show that they've been vaccinated or, you know, do their request for waivers. How many do you, obviously we've seen some problems in other areas. Have you had an issue with people complying with the request for that information?
Well, first of all, I want to just thank, our public employees who are joining us to lead by example. I want to thank our partners in labor. We have been sitting down and talking to representatives of the labor organizations. We're still collecting data, Brian, but we are at about 60% who have already reported their vaccination status to us. We're continuing to do outreach to encourage employees to do that. But look, if employees either aren't vaccinated or they choose not to submit their vaccination status to us, testing is the option here. So, and we're in partnership with and in talking to our labor groups, we're trying to make that as easy as possible. We're going to have testing available between shift changes, at or near work sites. So, you know, really.
But that means that 40% of your workforce has not handed in the paperwork, and you're almost 2 weeks past the deadline day. Does that concern you? And, I mean, ultimately, are you willing to fire people over this?
So, like I said, I think we're still collecting data. I'm confident that as we come closer to when the testing begins, that we're going to see that number continue to increase. I'm confident that there's a large portion of our workforce that has made the responsible decision to get vaccinated for themselves, for the public they serve. But look, if ultimately part of this process is if folks both, again, don't get vaccinated, or don't report it, and then also choose not to test as an option, progressive discipline is one of the things that we'll have to do as part of our process.
County Executive, you know, we've talked about this before, but the office, not just in Baltimore County, but Baltimore City at the state level, of the Inspector General is one that our audience has really looked at and focused on as kind of our voice in looking at how things work. I know you've publicly you support the office itself. Since there was the issue of legislation around Kelly Madigan, your inspector general, what has been done since then? Or where do things stand with her particular oversight, county executive?
Yeah, thanks, C4. First, I just want to say how proud we are of what we've done over the past 3 years. Baltimore County has been more open, accessible, and transparent than ever before. I mentioned the public financing, lobbying reform for cooling off, and we actually created the inspector general position. We've expanded that office every year since, in addition to other reforms. So I believe in this work. Some breaking news for you all this morning. We actually are announcing here and now. It's coming out this morning that we are expanding. Creating a commission to ensure that we have a government that upholds the highest standards of ethics and accountability. So it's going to be an independent blue ribbon commission on both ethics and accountability. It's a commission that has no one from the administration. No one's a county council employee. It's a group that includes a former state inspector general, the executive director of Common Cause, the chair of our county's ethics commission, and retired Judge Murphy, who was on Maryland's highest court. So we are going to make sure that we have best practices across the board, because I believe in this work. I want to sustain this work for administrations to come. And this is about best practices. So we're going to wait and hear what the commission has and follow their recommendations.
Well, I know Judge Murphy very well, but you couldn't get one more staffer for Kelly Madigan's office? I think she has a part-time staffer. How about a little, maybe one more person for her office?
Well, look, staffing will be one of the issues that we're asking this commission to look at. What should the size of the office be? Actually, the inspector general did ask for that position, and I funded it in our last budget cycle. So we have expanded the office every year since I've created it, and I'm happy to continue working with the inspector general to make sure she has the resources to be successful.
Last question, because this is a news story this morning. The Sun talks about Kathy Bevins, councilwoman, who moved out of her district that she represents. For a short time, she has since bought a condo or is now living in the district that she is representing. But it is against charter rules to move out, and it seems to be that the penalty is that you lose your job. What do you make of this, and should she still be a councilwoman today?
Well, as I understand it, and I think this was corroborated in the story that I read, is that her move was predicated on poor guidance from an attorney to the council. And I think as soon as it was brought to her attention, I know that she took steps to immediately amend the situation. So beyond that, I'd have to refer to, I think it's a council process in terms of their determination of residency and those sorts of issues. So I don't think anything that she did in this situation was malicious or ill-intentioned. I'm glad to see that she amended the situation as soon as it was brought to her attention. And unfortunately, like I said, it sounds like it was based on some poor guidance from, I think, where she tried to do the right thing in terms of understanding where she could be living relative to the charter.
Well, County Executive, thanks you for mentioning on our show about your commission that you're unveiling today. I look forward to talking with you in the future, Brian and I both, about where this commission goes and the transparency related to it. Thank you so much, Baltimore County Executive Jenny Olszewski.
Appreciate your time tremendously.
Sure thing, guys. Have a great week.
I appreciate it. We really have to get our guests better phones. We just have to. You and I could chip in together.
It comes
Dave will
in,
put,
it comes
Dave will
out,
put some money in.
But I think we got the gist of
we
it.
We got the gist
and
of
the
it.
The big problem is, what are you going to do with these people who don't want to get vaccinated, don't want to give you that information?
40%.
It's a pretty significant number.